Heavenly Father, we long for that day when we'll join the whole of creation in praising the Lord Jesus. And with every breath, we will sing the song of our salvation. We pray for your help now for every ounce of energy that we might attend to your holy word, that as the scriptures are opened and explained, that we might hear them and understand them and so know the wonderful grace of the Lord Jesus all the more. Give us clear thinking and humble hearts for your name's sake. Amen.
So the reading is starting at Hebrews chapter 9 from the beginning, and it's page 1206. Now the first covenant had regulations for worship and also an earthly sanctuary. A tabernacle was set up. In its first room were the lampstand, the table, and the consecrated bread. This was called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was a room called the most holy place, which had the old golden altar of incense and the gold-covered ark of the covenant. This ark contained the gold jar of manna, Aaron's staff that had budded, and the stone tablets of the covenant. Above the ark were the cherubim of the glory, overshadowing the atonement cover. But we cannot discuss these things in detail now. When everything had been arranged like this, the priests entered regularly into the outer room to carry on their ministry. But only the high priest entered the inner room, and that only once a year, and never without blood, which he offered for himself and for the sins of the people had committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit was showing by this that the way into the most holy place had not yet been disclosed as long as the first tabernacle was still standing. This is an illustration for the present time, indicating that the gifts and sacrifices being offered were not able to clear the conscience of the worshipper. They were only a matter of food and drink and various ceremonial washings, external regulations applying until the time of the new order. When Christ came as high priest of the good things that are already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not man-made. That is to say, not part of this creation. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his blood, having obtained eternal redemption. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God. For this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. In the case of a will, it is necessary to prove the death of the one who made it, because a will is in force only when somebody has died. It never takes effect while the one who made it is living. This is why even the first covenant was not put into effect without blood. When Moses had proclaimed every commandment of the law to all the people, he took the blood of calves, together with water, scarlet wool, and branches of hyssop, and sprinkled the scroll and all the people. He said, "This is the blood of the covenant which God has commanded you to keep." In the same way, he sprinkled with the blood both the tabernacle and everything used in its ceremonies. In fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. It was necessary then for the copies of the heavenly things to be purified with these sacrifices, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For God did not enter a man-made sanctuary that was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself, now to appear for us in God's presence. Nor did he enter heaven to offer himself again and again, the way the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood that is not his own. When Christ would have had to suffer many times since the creation of the world, but now he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Just as man is destined to die once and after that to face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. And he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. And now we turn to chapter 10, verse 11. Day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. Since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool, because by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. I'd love to come. What can I bring? You've invited a friend for a meal, and you explain to them, no need to bring anything, just yourselves. No, please, let me bring something, pudding, coffee, drinks, anything. There's no need, just come. Your friend won't take no for an answer. Phone calls, text messages, I'll bring anything, just tell me. You ignore the calls, but then the doorbell rings and your friend appears heavy laden. I couldn't help myself. Here's a pie, here's a crumble, and if you look in the envelope, there's £20 just to cover any costs I may incur. Has your friend been kind, or have they misunderstood friendship and the kind of friend you are? The offer was clear. Just come. Don't bring anything with you. I'm happy to cover the cost in full. The response was, thank you, but I must contribute. I must pay my way in some way. Well, we're now deep into the book of Hebrews, and this central section of chapters 5 to 10 is going to land in one place. Chapter 10, 19 to 25, we didn't have it read, but that is where it goes. Let me just read a few verses. This is the kind of landing of Hebrews chapters 5 to 10. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. It's as if God says, come, just come. And the author to the Hebrews says, draw near. Just draw near to God and keep drawing near because of the Lord Jesus and what he's done. That is where these central chapters head. We're to endure in our confidence in Christ, to keep relating to God as his forgiven children, trusting in him for our future. It's similar to a call in chapter 4. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence. The call is clear enough, isn't it? Draw near to God. Keep drawing near to God because of your confidence in Christ. The call is pretty clear, but the author knows it's hard for the Hebrews. And he knows they might well struggle with their Jewish neighbors, we might imagine, traipsing off to take their next sacrifice to the priest, and their next sacrifice, looked so tangible, as if they had every assurance that their sin was being dealt with. And in contrast to that, here is a naked call to come. Just come, just approach God's throne in heaven with confidence. Must have seemed so brazen, so presumptuous, so dangerous, so shaky. And so chapters 5 to 10 are there to give us the confidence to do that. Between the call in chapter 4, the call in chapter 10, to giving us the confidence to draw near to God, they focus on Jesus, our great high priest. We began to see that last week. And as we focus this week on chapters 9, specifically chapters 9, 11 to 14, we're really asking just how great is Jesus our high priest? Just how great is he? The answer comes in the form of a compare and contrast exercise. Just how great is he? Well, he is so much better than the priests of the old covenant. That's the answer in short. And we'll look at it under three contrasts. Here's the first point of contrast. He did not enter a copy of heaven, but heaven itself. Chapter 9, verse 11, just look there. And chapter 9, verse 24, you can look there. I'm just going to raise the microphone slightly. Chapter 9, verse 11, let me read it. When Christ came as high priest of the good things that are already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not man-made, that is to say, not a part of this creation. It's pretty similar in verse 24. Christ did not enter a man-made sanctuary that was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself, now to appear for us in God's presence. If you want an enjoyable but overpriced day out in the New Forest, you could book something called Battlefield Live. You get to wear camouflage, you get a gun, you get to go on missions and capture people and kill people, all very exciting if you enjoy that sort of thing, but it is just a copy of the real battlefield. The guns don't have bullets, they have lasers. And if we were to ask one of the soldiers in our morning congregation, the next time you deploy, would you like one of these guns? They would not trade in their weapon for a fake one, would they? A copy, a replica gun. And so too for the Jewish tabernacle. It was just a copy of the real thing. The tabernacle, many will know, was a kind of mobile temple, a forerunner of the temple. And it was a deeply significant replica that God himself had designed. But it was just a copy. It was a replica of heaven itself and how someone approaches God. The things in it were amazing. We heard them mentioned in verses 1 to 5 of our reading. The stone tablets which spoke of covenant, God's commitment to his people. The cherubim of glory, which spoke of God's presence with his people. The atonement cover, which spoke of God's provision of forgiveness. Amazing things in the tabernacle. The author doesn't go into detail. We won't go into detail either. But one thing he does dwell on is the whole entrance into the most holy place. The outer room was the normal place of activity for a priest. Just look at verse 6. When everything had been arranged like this, the priests entered regularly into the outer room to carry on their ministry. So this replica of heaven, this tabernacle, it had an outer room. That's where the priests usually did their thing, verse 6. The inner room, the most holy place where God symbolically dwelt, well, it was much more dangerous to enter. Verse 7, it was a rare thing for someone to enter. Verse 7, but only the high priest entered the inner room, and that only once a year, and never without blood, which he offered for himself and for the sins the people had committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit was showing by this that the way into the most holy place had not yet been disclosed, as long as the first tabernacle was still standing. So what was going on in this replica, the tabernacle which became the temple? Well, the Jewish priests were kind of enabling people to come to God, but only kind of. They could enter his presence, so to speak, but only once a year, and only with a lot of blood, and only after the high priest had gone through this elaborate ritual of cleansing and sacrifice, and then they had to leave again after that day. They were kind of entering God's presence, but it was only a copy. It was a replica of heaven itself. And we're to contrast that with the ministry of Jesus. Verse 11 again, when Christ came as high priest of the good things that are already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not man-made. That is to say, not part of this creation. You see, the Hebrews needed to see that however impressive the Jewish priests looked, actually like they were like children playing with Monopoly money. It wasn't the real thing. It was just a foretaste. The risen Lord Jesus has actually entered the presence of his Father. He's actually opened up a way to God, which had one day previously been shut. He'd made possible genuine relationship with God. If you'd arrived at Mombasa in 1880 on the coast of Kenya, the 500-mile journey to Lake Victoria would have been very dangerous and difficult, not least because there were lions en route. They became known as the man-eaters of Tsavo for obvious reasons. But eventually, at the cost of many lives, that railway line to Lake Victoria was completed. A way was opened up through this dense and dangerous bush. And so you could travel in peace and safety to Lake Victoria. Well, at the cost of his life, you can see the parallel. The Lord Jesus has actually opened up a way to the living God. He has actually entered heaven itself, a way into the very presence of the Father. Unlike the workers on that railway line, it became known as the lunatic line, so dangerous it was to build. Unlike those workers who died and stayed dead, the Lord Jesus is alive, now appearing in heaven itself, acting on behalf of God's people. The way to God is open for all those who are in Jesus. Now that is a wonderful reality. But it might be that we're not quite ready to draw near to God with confidence for all of this week. And that might be because we're still kind of wondering, well, what about our sin? Has it actually been dealt with? Well, here's the second point of comparison between Jesus and the Jewish priests of old. He did not enter with animal blood, but his own. Let me read chapter 9, verse 12. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. In chapters 9 to 10, blood comes up 13 times, I think. It is everywhere. And that is not because the liquid content of blood is somehow magically powerful. It's because blood in the Bible speaks of one thing, which is a life poured out in violent sacrificial death. Think of the blood of the Passover lamb in Egypt as it was daubed above the doorway. The blood showed that the lamb had been sacrificed so that the firstborn son could survive. Blood in the Bible speaks of sacrificial death. And here, that contrast is being made. Not the blood of bulls and goats as the Jewish priests administered, but the blood of the Lord Jesus himself. It's not that the Old Testament sacrifices were a waste of time. Verse 13, the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. You see, the tabernacle sacrifices did make people outwardly clean. You could live in the camp of Israel as that blood was shed, as the sacrifice was made. And yet they did not actually deal with sin. Just glance down to chapter 10, verse 4. I'll read from verse 3, actually. Those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Of course, we should expect that to be the case, shouldn't we? If death, human death, is the wages for human sin, how could the death of a bull ever be a fair swap, or a goat, or a pigeon? It's not a fair swap, is it? Death of a human for death of a pigeon. But actually, the Lord Jesus, well, when it comes to his sacrificial death, it is a different thing altogether. Verse 14, how much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God? For the first time, here is human blood, a human death, and not just any human death, but an unblemished human death. A human who's lived an unblemished life, who doesn't deserve to die, but who is being sacrificed. The high priest, the perfect priest, becomes the perfect sacrifice as Jesus offers himself on a cross. If you like, two different types of cleansing are being contrasted. If you own a bike, there are two ways you can clean the grime and oil off your chain. You can go for toothbrush plus soapy water. It's not totally useless. It will get a bit of the grime off. The chain will look and feel a bit cleaner, at least for a while. Option two is this stuff. Citrus degreaser, other brands probably available. I don't know what they put in here, but I'm amazed it's legal. Run your chain through this stuff, and the mud, the grime, the oil, it just falls away. Your chain is left almost like new. It's a different kind of cleansing altogether. And so with the Lord Jesus, his death, it is a different kind of cleansing. The Old Testament sacrifice is outward cleansing. The sacrifice of the Lord Jesus, cleansed truly. As the verse puts it, our consciences are cleansed from acts that lead to death because Jesus died. And did you see that actually frees us to serve God? End of verse 14, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we may serve the living God. That is a great reversal of the general religious way of thinking. Religion thinks that serving is a way to get a clear conscience, doesn't it? So I go to church, or I serve at the food bank, or I give money to charity, and I hope I've done enough to get a clear conscience. I remember meeting a Roman Catholic chap called Edmund. I said, can you be confident God will accept you? I hope so. I've been to Mass quite recently. I haven't done anything too bad since then. Many people think of serving as a way to kind of get a clear conscience. But here, that order is flipped. Do you see that? Because Jesus served us, dying for us, his blood shed for us, our conscience is cleansed so that you can serve God. Be freed to serve God without fear, knowing that you don't need to earn your way. With your service, you're not adding anything to your status as a forgiven person. So the Lord Jesus, as our high priest, he didn't enter with his own blood. He didn't enter with animal blood. He did enter with his own blood. But I guess one of the things that made those Jewish priests in the days of the book of Hebrews so attractive was the sheer regularity of their service. Every day must have been a comforting thing to see them doing their thing in the temple or the tabernacle. That daily repeated sacrifice on your behalf. And many people seek the same sort of comfort today, don't they? A regular trip to church. A repeated thing that you do every month. A standing order, a church prayer meeting, a daily quiet time, a confession to a priest, whatever it is. We often seek assurance through discipline and ritual and performance in some way. But if we do that, we're actually forgetting or ignoring the power of Jesus' death. How great is Jesus our high priest? Final point of contrast, Jesus' sacrifice does not need repeating. It is once for all. If you need to have a hip operation repeated, the reality, which you will know very well, is that the hip was not fixed the first time round. And the same goes for the Old Testament sacrifices. Just look at chapter 10, verses 1 to 3. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. If it could, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshippers would have been cleansed once for all and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins, because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. If you're not a follower of Jesus, the Lord Jesus is offering you a different kind of sacrifice. One death which deals with everything. Just look over at chapter 10, verse 11. I might just read from verse 12. But when this priest, the Lord Jesus, had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. Since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool, because by one sacrifice, he's made perfect forever those who are being made holy. So many things in life do need repeating: cleaning your teeth, paying your taxes, getting your car MOT'd. So many things need doing again and again, don't they? But because of the Lord Jesus and what he's done, dealing with sin never needs repeating. Because of one death, the Lord Jesus, dying on a cross outside Jerusalem, because he paid for everything, because his blood, his sacrifice, is an unblemished one, well, all sin is paid for. Nothing is left to pay for yourself if you've come to him. Now, followers of Jesus here this evening, that is the word that we need, I suggest, to calm us and reassure us. Just think about the difference between the Jewish priests and the Lord Jesus. Verse 11 of chapter 10, they are standing and performing, day after day standing. But verse 12, Jesus had offered for all time one sacrifice. He sat down at the right hand of God. I'm standing now. I suppose in some sense I'm working. When I finish speaking, I'll sit down because I'll have finished working. And the Lord Jesus, he was hanging on the cross. He was making the sacrifice. The sacrifice was made. And now he's entered heaven and sat down at the right hand of the Father. He's waiting for his final victory. Language of Psalm 110, you might remember. But don't you love the tenses, verse 14? By one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being holy. Do you remember perfect in Hebrews doesn't mean morally perfect? It means perfectly qualified. So by one sacrifice that has been made 2,000 odd years ago, he has made perfect. He's perfectly qualified, past tense, those of us being made holy. That's those of us trusting in the Lord Jesus. So it does not need repeating. It was once for all. And let's just dwell on that for a moment as we prepare to close. No more sacrifice for sin is needed. No more. Not the sacrifice of Mass. The official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church is that the weekly Mass extends Jesus' sacrifice. The death of Jesus and the weekly Mass, they are one. One extends the other. Do you see that that is directly opposed to the teaching of the Bible? Jesus' sacrifice either is finished or it's not. And Hebrews is saying it is finished, so he is sitting down. Nothing left to pay for. It's no wonder that our Roman Catholic friends often lack assurance, because they need that sacrifice to be extended each week. And yet, if you think I'm being unfair to Roman Catholics, one doesn't have to be a Roman Catholic to be insecure about our salvation. Many of us might live with that same insecurity. Yes, Jesus died for me, but surely I think somewhere in my subconscious, I've got to top up that sacrifice to really know assurance. I've got to pray every day, then I could die confidently. I've got to kick that habit. I've got to feel more joyful. I've got to be more proactive about sharing my faith, whatever it is. We often think and live as if we need to top up the sacrifice that Jesus has made. It either is finished or it's not finished. Once for all, he offered for all time one sacrifice for sins. If you dwell on two words, or even three words if I can count, they would be once for all this week. Once for all. Once for all, to deal with your sins of yesterday, your sins of today, your sins of tomorrow. Once for all, to deal with your sins of thought and word and deed. Once for all, to deal with those big sins that haunt you sometimes, and those just embarrassing and irritating sinful habits. Once for all, one death for all of your sins. One preacher puts it, it's easy to explain and understand, it's nigh on impossible to believe. Can you believe it is a once for all sacrifice? The Church of England prayer book puts it brilliantly in one of the prayers for the communion service from the old prayer book. It says this, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, here it is, by his one oblation, that means giving, of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. Do you think they were trying to say you need to top up his sacrifice? Or do you think they were trying to say it's a once-for-all sacrifice? No more sacrifice needed, because Jesus paid once for all of your sin. Doesn't mean we can keep on sinning. If we think that, then Hebrews chapter 12, the early verses, will correct us and call us to throw off every sin. It does mean that we need not atone for our sin and top up the sacrifice. So as I finish, when you have an assurance wobble this week, will you look up in your mind's eye and think of Jesus sitting down? And will you say to yourself, oh yes, he's sitting down because his work of sacrifice is finished. Not half finished, but fully finished. He has dealt with my sin. And when you have a prayer wobble, as it were, this week, thinking, will God really hear me after everything I've done or failed to do? Will you have a brief word with yourself and say it was a once-for-all sacrifice? He paid fully then, on the cross, once for all, so I'm going to draw near to God with confidence because of the blood of the Lord Jesus shed for me. Think back to that opening illustration. Just come, you say to your friend when you invite them for dinner. The Lord God says, just come. We sung about it in one of the words of our songs. I approach the throne of glory, nothing in my hands I bring. The reason we need to bring nothing to deal with our sin is because a once-for-all sacrifice has already dealt with our sin. Great evening for sharing the Lord's Supper together. We remember that once-for-all sacrifice. We're not repeating it. We're not extending it. We're remembering it and rejoicing in it. Shall we pray? And then we'll sing. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith. Loving Father, we praise you that we have the privilege of drawing near to you, knowing that a once-for-all sacrifice for our sin has happened. We praise you that we can think of the Lord Jesus sitting down at your right hand, having finished the work of dealing with our sin. And may that be our confidence this week. Please take our eyes off ourselves and help us to put them on the Lord Jesus and his finished work on the cross. And so please keep us as a church family drawing near to you. We praise you for our salvation in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I think as we sing again, the second word of the song is the key one, finished.